in his prison term, mm-hmm. they are both waiting mm-hmm. and hoping not to be disappointed. They're on the they are, you know, both children
so
waiting
good.
For daddy
right.
that said,
so
I'm going to come and get you on Saturday.
Yes.
We're going to the game.
Yes.
We both share that same hope and that same space.
Yeah.
And, you know,
was we the,
and dysfunction in the families.
Yeah.
My family as well as
exactly.
yours.
Exactly. And I do love that we get to see in that moment a real humanized side, I think, of Bernadine, because of the fact that you are expressing that desire for hope within the confines of doing your job. But at the same time, you know, this movie explores what happens to the people who have to carry out these sentences. Mm-hmm. And something we may not think about on a regular basis, but when we do think about it, the perspective might be that these are individuals who have a lack of humanity, a loss, a sense of deprivation to a degree. Yeah. But we get to see through Bernadine that's absolutely not true.
Whoa.
Mike Muse is an industrial engineer, a music executive, a political architect. He breaks down the intersection of politics and pop culture. This is the Mike Muse Show.
All's my life I has to fight. All's my life I hard times like yeah, bad trips like yeah. Nazareth, I'm f***ed up, homie, you f***ed up. But if God got us, then we gon' be alright.
We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright.
What's up, brother? It's your boy, Mike Muse. Welcome to the episode of The Mike Muse Show. I am so excited to be in conversation with you today. As you know, I'm in no competition with anyone else but myself. And I try and outdo myself every single time to bring you the best conversations as possible, the most interesting, the most fascinating guests from the most interesting perspective. And so, holding to the fire, I hope I'm able to do it. I gotta say, I'm super excited because the lady next to me has been someone who I've always wanted to interview as soon as I got my show, The Mike Muse Show, because I was on the road with her on the campaign journey, the political journey during our Obama days. We won't get into too much politics today. The amazing, the talented, the incredible Alfre Woodard. What is happening?
Oh my, you just lifted me up. I am happy to be here.
Like, it's an honor. One, I've always admired, I'm getting to you all this in a second. I've always admired your work. Yeah, your work ethic is amazing. The layers that you bring to the screen, big and small, is very moving. I love your nuance and the simple ways of your gestures, how you stand, how you grab a cup, how you watch TV on the couch in this new film, Clemency. You always bring your whole self into the role, and I just get lost in your character. I forget it's you, and I get lost in the character. And then to couple that with all the activism that you brought, you worked tirelessly on the campaign for both terms, and you did it with no fanfare, and you did it because you believed in the cause and what you were doing. And you'll be surprised at how many individuals I came across with, no shots fired to anyone, who are doing it for branding purposes, right? Yes. And so thank you for bringing your authentic self in order for change. So I'm so happy to have you on this show today.
I appreciate you, and thank you for reminding me. You just charged me to stay on point going forward.
It's important. Yeah. And the gentleman to your right, the incredible talented who I got the chance to get introduced to in the film, straight out of Compton. I cannot wait to dive more into him and his ability to act. You've seen him also, too, on the show Underground. Also on a couple of shows on TNT as that guy on Leverage. And so I'm so excited to have you, Aldis. What's happening, Aldis Hodge, brother?
What's happening, man? I'm good. I'm hanging. I'm good, man. Life is right now.
I can imagine. I'm really interested to pull forward more so that your ability to play violin and the clarinet as a woodwinds player, as a saxophone player.
Used to be.
I'm always intrigued by alto saxophone.
My brother was alto.
Yeah. And so I'm always intrigued by actors who have an artistic background through instrumentation. Mm-hmm. I was interviewing Terry Crews, and what got discovered that he was a fine arts, not a major, but he went to a special conservative. Blue Lake, actually, in order to really focus on that. And so me and him had a really incredible conversation, man. So good to have you on the Mike Muse Show.
Oh, man,
brother.
Thank you, man. Yeah.
They are here, ladies and gentlemen, to talk about this powerful film called Clemency. As you know, social justice is the new arm in the creative world to me in Hollywood. I believe Hollywood is the new arm of social justice. I believe that the way that the scripts are moving right now and projects are really bringing narratives that are needed to cause and really needed to change. And Clemency with Death Row is something that we're really paying attention to right now in our society with all the recent events that is going on. And this movie is moving. It's jarring. And what I really leaned into was the pacing of the film, right? The pacing of the film was unlike anything I've experienced. It was almost haunting. Yeah. So, Alfre, talk to me as a producer before you get into the acting, how important it was for you guys to discuss the pacing of this film.
I think Chinoyo Chukwu is our filmmaker. And I think she attracted a lot of us because she talked about how she wanted to make the film and how it would have a natural pacing that reflected life inside the walls in the prison. It wouldn't be rushed. It wouldn't be sort of hyper-romanticized with violence or any of those things that we've seen before, and that you're going to attract actors when you say, we're not jump cutting, we're not doing that. I'm going to let the camera roll, because we all understand that life actually happens between the lines. Yeah. It's not what you say. You say things that get towards your intention, that you want to get something from the person you're communicating with. And so we all were not only unafraid of that, that's the way life is, but a lot of directors work in a way that interferes with that to force the not only the visual on people, but how they receive it. And so we knew that we had a maestro. There would be music, there would be a conductor. It wasn't just, you know, everybody tooting their own. I played flute and piccolo.
Hey, come on now. Come on, instruments. Yeah. Well, I want to talk to you too, because, and speaking of that, right, the pacing, the maestro, the music, there's also elements of silence that was there, right? Mm-hmm. And your character, the film is partly centered around you, your character, and your character as well, Bernadette. But your character doesn't have a lot of words, right?
He definitely doesn't have a lot of words, but he definitely speaks loudly. For me, the character, playing this sort of character, was an exploration into the truth of emotion, right? The character, for me, was a vehicle for trying to figure out how to hold on to hope, how to fabricate hope, how to build it up. He's been in prison at this point on death row 16, 15 years, right? Still fighting for clemency. So at every single turn, any day they could say, hey, look, this is it. Your time is up and it's time to go. How do you fight through that? How do you fight for yourself? How do you hold on to your own personal value through it all and not just completely tear down? And that is what I love that I had a chance to sort of display with him in sort of play and find, is that even in our quiet moments, how you respond to the world, how you react to the world, how the world reacts to you, you can still speak volumes without having to say so much, because it's all in your emotions. It's we read each other's energy, we read emotions. And when it comes to certain scenes where the challenge is communicating and speaking without saying words, I mean, as an actor, you just kind of eat those up, but also my ambition for what people are going to watch and how they're going to watch it says to me that I hope I can communicate in this the true depth of the situation.
Yeah.
You know, emotionally, and what's really happening in your head and in your heart.
Yeah. A part to me that really stood out, there was one scene in the film, I mean, you guys probably collectively said maybe 20 words. and it was a scene, and I'm not going to give too much of the movie away, when you were waiting for a loved one to come, right? I won't say which one, right? But you were waiting for a loved one to come. Oof. And then, Alfre, you were moderating, right?
Yeah.
Kind of trying to monitor the situation to make sure. That was the most moving part of the film to me, mm-hmm. because the tension that existed, yeah. right? The nervousness, right? And really the hope right?
Yeah.
The hope you needed to maintain, right? Yeah. The hope you wanted for this individual. Yeah. And then the individual that wasn't there, the hope that you hope they would have for reconciliation,
yeah.
right? And we often get lost in that, and we forget about how prison impacts families, mm-hmm. right? And loved ones, right?
Yeah.
Talk to us why that scene was so important to dive into all that tension.
Well, I think it is. It's about family, always, mm-hmm. because every person has a history. They've got a history, they've got connection, they've got roots everywhere. Mm-hmm. So when you incarcerate someone, it's good to make sure that you're right about incarcerating mm-hmm. them. You know, there are debts to be paid when you overstep and you're not only you break the law but you need to know that that's only one person standing in front of you. An entire, not only family, the communities are affected. So in telling our story, and it takes place inside, and it takes when we're and we come in at a critical moment in Bernadine's career. She says, I'm good at what I do. And she has been, because she does her job well. It's a tough job, and it's not for the faint of heart,
yeah. mm-hmm.
but it's for people who are compassionate, but they understand that compassion has to be expressed in boundaries as well.
Yes.
And so we see her there, but she is thinking twice just because her relationship with this prisoner
yeah.
has jogged her confidence
yeah.
and her sense of morality and what mm-hmm. that is. So we see her struggle with that.
Mm-hmm.
The thing is, she really never steps out of protocol, mm-hmm. but that's when she's really willing to say, you know what? I have to do this. I don't know how I'm doing this. So the two of them, for the first time in the film and in his prison term, mm. they are both waiting mm. and hoping not to be disappointed. They're on the
yes.
They are, you know, both children so waiting good. For daddy
right.
that said,
so
I'm
good.
Gonna come and get you on Saturday.
Yes.
We're going to the game.
Yes.
We both share that same hope and that same space.
Yeah.
And you know,
was we
the, and dysfunction else. In yeah. the families.
Yeah. yeah.
My family as well as yours.
Exactly. And I do love that we get to see in that moment a real humanized side, I think, of Bernadine, because of the fact that you are expressing that desire for hope within the confines of doing your job. But at the same time, you know, this movie explores what happens to the people who have to carry out these sentences. Mm-hmm. And something we may not think about on a regular basis, but when we do think about it, the perspective might be that these are individuals who have a lack of humanity, a loss, a sense of deprivation to a degree.
Yeah.
But we get to see through Bernadine that's absolutely not true. Mm-hmm. And in those moments, and I'm really glad you called out that scene, we get to see this warden hoping for something for her ward.
Yes.
You know what I mean? And it gives you a completely different perspective of how these people may actually live when it comes to doing their jobs on a regular basis.
Yes.
So the next time you come to the idea, you're like, wait a minute.
Yes.
Is this something that should continue? We should probably do a lot more work.
Yes.
I mean, a lot of us say that we're against the death penalty, and I do truly believe that in a lot of people, but something that this movie has really done is call to mind, how do we actually take action about, you know, putting our work behind our words and our beliefs?
Yeah. yeah. But I think what's so interesting about this, and where you both have led me to, is bringing the human nature to this.
Yeah.
The death penalty is a complicated subject matter, right?
Quite
and
so.
It's important that for the first time, I got to be honest with you guys, right? I've always been anti-death penalty, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I've never been passionate about it, right? Because I was always disconnected from the human nature of it.
Right.
It's one thing to read it. It's one thing to read a New York Times article. It's one thing to see an op-ed about it. It's one thing to see a news report on it. But then it's another thing to actually see it on the screen for 2 hours, right? Mm. And deal with the humanity that gets brought to it as a warden, as a prisoner, but as an advocate. And it made me understand that we have to begin to talk about this policy differently. And when you bring the human nature into it, it becomes more real, right? It becomes more community, right? Because we're all impacted by it. I had the chance, it's really interesting, I'm in conversation with you two, but I had the chance to be in conversation with Brian Stevenson on my show recently. Yes. I think audience, you remember that conversation. It was a tireless advocate for freeing prisoners off of the death row. And I had the chance to read letters that people wrote to him about feeling hopelessness when it comes to that. So with you, Alfre, I was going to call you Bernadine. I got to take care of it with you. So with you, Alfre, the character Bernadine, talk to us about, is there space, right? Because you sat with wardens of state prisons. Is there a space for wardens to do their job and to have compassion for the prisoners that are on death row and also to maybe want change within the death row system?
Every warden that I met, and I met the director of corrections as well, met Mr. Ault, who has taken more people through that process. Everybody's waiting for that call. Everybody sits there waiting for that call. They don't want to do that. It is traumatizing to their soul and their core to have to do it. So they're waiting for that call. I think there is the guy that I met, the director of corrections at Ohio, he has moved on to another position now. Mm-hmm. But it probably depends on who your governor is, who the director of corrections are, how much wiggle room you have. You know how to keep order, but it's just like a president. There's rules that most presidents follow. There's laws. There's protocol. So people say, well, it doesn't matter who it is. The office runs itself. It matters the timbre and the temperature. Mm-hmm. It matters. It sets a template of how to behave, how to be a neighbor and a citizen for all the other citizens. Ooh. It matters. So the warden can have that. That is their decision. You still keep protocol, but you see, she said, I'm sorry, you can't go to your mother's funeral. I'll have somebody call you after it and they can tell you about it. But when she did decide, she could decide, I'm going to have this. I'm stepping in at this moment. So they come from mental health. The wardens, they come from social work. So that part of them, they make decisions. They're not people that say, when they're little, I like pulling the wings off a bird, so I'm going to be a warden. That's not, it's not black mama, white mama. Remember that back in the day? There was this movie, like prison movies.
Oh, yeah.
Because everybody just wanted the inmates fighting and girl fighting and stuff. No, it's not. It is not like that. It is people trying to find some dignity and some humanity within an inhuman situation of ritualized murder. It's going to go on.
Yes.
Yeah. So Bernadine and other women that I saw said, I'm going to be there to make sure that it happens with that as least pain, spiritually, emotionally, and physically for everybody involved.
And dignity for the person,
Alfre, I could not think of a better way to end that conversation than on that right there. You really captured the nuance of the death penalty. You really captured the nuance of the humanity and the human existence within this space from all parties involved, right or wrong. You really captured that. So thank you for bringing that to this conversation. Thank you for bringing that to your performance. Aldis, thank you for the incredible vulnerability that you showed on screen. I really believe your character will help us see prisoners on death row from this humane perspective.
Therefore,
we can best advocate for them. Shout out to the producer in the room, Bronwyn Cornelius, for producing such a fantastic film. We love you, Bronwyn. Please, please, please make sure you go see Clemency December 27th. You will definitely be changed after seeing this movie. Until next time, folks, peace.
This is America. Don't catch you slipping now. don't catch you slipping now. Look what I'm whipping now. This is America. Don't catch you slipping now. Don't catch you slipping now. Look what I'm whipping now. This is America. Don't catch you slipping now. Look how I'm living now. Police be tripping now. Yeah, this is America. Guns in my area.
What's up, world? It's your boy, Mike Muse. Welcome back from that very powerful conversation that we just had with Alfre Woodard and her co-star Aldis Hodge on the film Clemency. I cannot tell you enough how much you have to see this film. I had a chance to see a band screening of it, and it was powerful. It was moving. It really put death row and the ecosystem of death row into a completely different space for me. It humanized the character of the warden and what they are thinking in those moments. It put in perspective the priest. It put in perspective the officers who have to escort the individuals to the actual chambers itself. It really wrapped around family. It really wrapped around community. And it really gave me a completely different perspective on how I view the death penalty. I gotta be honest with you, coming into it, I've always been anti-death penalty, but not until lately seeing Just Mercy, seeing Clemency, have I got to a passion for how much the death penalty needs to be eliminated across the board on state level and federal levels. The amount of time that individuals are found innocent and still have the possibility that they are will be on death row and that they will be executed and they won't be able to grant clemency or stays. It's just unfathomable to me that we would still allow such executions to go forward when the error rate is just too profound, right? Even if this one is found innocent and so executed, that's one way too many. It's a flawed system that we have. Ironically, I feel like I'm doing an entire series. You've been with me for a while now, so you recognize that last week we did Just Mercy with Bryan Stevenson, which was very powerful. So we had the chance to see it from an advocate space, from an attorney whose sole mission in life is to get individuals off of death row and to make sure that justice is served to them. So we heard it from his perspective. Today, we heard it from the perspective of a warden's point of view, right? And what wardens are thinking. So today was more from an administrative standpoint of view. I'm a little bit of cat out of the bag. I cannot wait to have the exclusive town hall right here at SiriusXM with the lead actors of Just Mercy, Michael B. Jordan and Jamie Foxx. Michael B. Jordan plays Bryan Stevenson in the film, and Jamie Foxx plays a prisoner who was wrongly convicted and sent to death row, who later Bryan Stevenson ends up getting him off of death row. So I feel like I'm creating this trilogy without even really realizing it. And I think it's important. I believe that art is the new arm of social justice. Art has a way of really bringing to light these issues, these policies, and these topics, and it makes it real. It makes it substantive. It's no longer just this esoteric policy that's being shaped in the state capitol or in the halls of Congress, but it actually has real impact on lives, the human condition, the raw emotions. I really felt myself going through the pacings of all the characters that were involved in both films of Just Mercy and in Clemency in terms of how to process community, as a community advocate, as a community member, as a brother, as a son, as a friend. It made me think about just how close we really are to death penalty and how we have to make sure we are tireless advocates and we stay vigilant within this case. The death penalty, man, it needs to be eradicated. But how do we resolve it? How do we move forward in this process? We have an attorney general right now, an administration that is more pro death penalty, is looking to bring back death penalty on a federal level. We are in the 2020 election cycle, and the Democrats have a very robust field of candidates who are vying to go against President Trump, and to ultimately their goal is to take back the White House from a Democratic Party point of view. President Trump doesn't need to have any challengers right now at this time, or any credible challengers, that is, and so it's going to be him versus a Democrat. And we all have this notion of what can I do? right? Every time I talk to you across the country, you call into the morning show, you guys always ask me questions. How can I get involved? You're sending me DMs. You're tweeting me these information. And I'm saying, this is the time. Have you ever noticed that when you see these town halls on news, at your 6 p.m. evening news, your 6:30 evening news, or your 24-hour news channel, they always show these individuals asking the elected officials questions. They always show these individuals asking the candidates questions. That's really how you get to put the pressure on these politicians and these candidates on the issues of the death penalty. So if you are an advocate of the death penalty, you have the right to be able to talk to your sitting elected official or a candidate who is vying for that position and ask them about the death penalty. Ask them, what would they do? Where do they stand? What's their positioning? You, the American public, have the power to actually bring to light in the forefront the death penalty in order to help eradicate it. It starts with us, right? It starts with us creating this groundswell of information for it to come along. And it's important for us to really make sure that we have the focus on that one. So I thought what I would do is I'll bring in a really dear friend of mine. She is a fantastic grassroots campaign organizer. She's worked in the Obama administration, both on this campaign and administration, to really talk to us about what does progressive candidates look like, what does progressive advocacy look like, and how do we move forward to making sure that we put these issues at the forefront, because it's very complicated. A lot of us don't feel like we have the influence. A lot of people don't feel like they have the power in order to bring those issues forward. So my good friend Karine, she's going to come on the show, and she's really going to talk to us about how to engage in this 2020 cycle, how we should be looking at the candidates, how we should be looking at the filter of the candidates, and what we feel we should be moving on. I am extremely excited to have her in conversation. I think she is the best person to have moderate, not so much this discourse of the death penalty per se, but moderate this discourse of how do we move forward and what are some basic practical tools that we need to bring forth policy, to bring forth change, and to make sure that we bring our issues to the forefront. So listen, stay with us. It's a very powerful jam-packed show that we have today. It's a trilogy that I see myself in the makings, and I think I might have to do like a bundle show so we can bundle all three shows together to really see the story arc of it all. Let me know your thoughts. Feel free to tweet me, as always, at I am Mike Muse, M-U-S-N-S-A-M-E, on Twitter and Instagram. As always, here at Urban View, at SXM Urban View on Twitter and on Instagram. So stay with us. Coming up next, we have my good friend Karine.
You're listening to the Mike Muse Show.
What's up, world? It's your boy, Mike Muse. Welcome to the episode of the Mike Muse Show. I am so excited you have joined me today for another fascinating conversation. As you guys know, I'm in competition with no one but myself, and I always try and outdo myself every single time to bring you the best conversations in ways I've never thought I could have, to bring you fascinating individuals who I find very curious and interesting and intriguing, and of course, super duper smart. That has to be the main criterion coming on the Mike Muse Show. And ladies and gentlemen, I have found it. I think I have outdone myself. And unfortunately, as you know, this one is a friend, so you already know the friend alert, which means this conversation can go anywhere. I'm going to try and keep it as linear as possible, but it may get really difficult, so I apologize in advance to you, my audience. For those of you who are listening in your cars, in your trucks, in your offices, you may not be able to see the lovely dynamic. The super-duper lady who is sitting to my right, her name goes, is Karine Jean-Pierre. What is happening?
Hi, Mike. It's so good to see you. Thank you. What a wonderful intro. Yo, I appreciate that.
I am so excited. I've been watching you for a while, literally and figuratively. Figuratively, just as our partnership and friendship has emerged over almost 10 years, now 10 plus years, but then literally on television, I'm sure you guys have all seen her too before, MSNBC correspondent and analyst, also to the political affairs director for MoveOn.org. But today she is here for something very special. She is an author now, so we can add that to her slash. You know, we're living in a slash generation. So she has written this beautiful book, so I'm going to model the book for her really quickly. It's Moving Forward, a story of hope, hard work, and the promise of America. Just to give you a little bit of insight on this, I have known her since the Obama days, since the Obama campaign, 2008. She worked tirelessly to get that young man elected, as we all did, and we were all in the trenches for that. But our friendship really formed when she went inside the White House, became the Northeast Regional Political Affairs Director for the White House, and she and I would meet. She was so kind. She had an incredible busy schedule. I don't know if you you remember all
insane.
These days. But no, every time I was in D.C., you literally would take time to meet with me at Off the Record.
Off the record. It had to be off the record.
Off the record, literally and figuratively.
All times. Yeah.
But for those of you who don't know, there is a bar called Off the Record in the Hayes Adam Hotel, which is located directly across the street from the White House.
Yep.
And so there we were off the record. Now we're on the record on the Mike Muse Show.
That's so true.
Could you
congratulations.
Imagine?
Oh. Can I say congratulations on your show? I listen
so
to
much.
It. It's so much fun. It is so Mike Muse.
Yes.
as your intro showed. Yeah. And so, so congratulations on this. It's perfect for you. It's like you have just a big, big heart and a great personality.
So. Oh, man, thank you so much for that.
Absolutely.
I mean, could you imagine? And I was thinking about this, and I knew you were coming, and I fought to get her, just FYI, backdoor channels in the whole nine. You're one of the friends who have a book out I want to support. For me, this is the reason why these type of platforms exist, that our friends that we have. You know, if we don't have these platforms, why should we even have the platforms if we can't pull each other up and advocate and celebrate?
Yeah.
Celebrate your brilliance when it comes to that. But I don't know what's mean for you, but I was just thinking, like, I cannot believe she's coming on my show. We used to meet Off the Record.
Yes.
And now
yes.
Look at our trajectories.
And plan.
I could never imagine I would have a radio show. I would never imagine a career in media.
Go.
And then did you ever see yourself as an author?
Oh, that is such a good question.
Cable news analyst working for this incredible organization.
So I never saw myself as an analyst or being on TV. I actually write about that in the book. The first time I was ever told, hey, you could be on TV. Like you can do this and you have the resume to do it. And I remember thinking, oh, not me, because I grew up incredibly shy.
Yeah.
I wish I had your big, wonderful personality. But I grew up painfully shy.
Yeah.
And even today, it's hard for me. It's hard for me to even be in front of a camera because it's just not what I'm accustomed to. It's not part of even the culture that I grew up in an immigrant culture. You're taught, you sit on the sideline.
Yeah.
You don't speak up unless you're spoken to. And so I am shocked to see where I am today. Now, with the book, I've always wanted to write a book.
Yeah.
For a long time, I felt like I wanted to tell my story. I had a story to tell. I wanted to help people, inspire people, motivate people. So the writing the book is not surprising. It's not easy writing a book, so I don't want to make it sound like it was something that was easy. It took a lot of work. It took a lot of deep thought. And there's some really raw, honest stuff in the book that I talk about. And so that was, the process was tough and hard because I was processing my own stuff, but I knew I've always wanted to. I felt like I had a story to tell that would inspire people and motivate people.
What I find interesting about that, and I love hearing narratives of individuals like this, because it always reminds me that, you know, there's something bigger out there that's working on our behalf.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
like,
that's true.
This universe
is an interesting place.
like here you are, this shy kid, right?
Absolutely.
Who ends up finding her voice to becoming this incredible voice for the progressive movement.
Yeah, well, thank you.
I find the irony in that for myself is that I used to hate the sound of my voice, right?
Oh, interesting.
I never got comfortable with my voice until literally about 4 years ago. I actually came to peace with it. I used to thought that my voice was too high. It was too high pitch. As I get excited, you'll hear me. I go extremely high. The octaves go all the way up. And I always find myself trying to modulate my voice, right? Trying to make it sound fuller, right? Mm. And make it sound deeper. And long and behold, here I am using my voice, right, for
radio
advocacy,
too.
Right?
Advocacy,
and just trying to inspire and give hope, right? And to put things in context. And, like, my voice is now my career, right?
Right.
And so it's amazing how God uses us in places that we didn't thought. Now, going on to the book, when I read the title, Moving Forward, Sort of Hope, Hard Work, and the Promise of America, I was curious where the angle was going to go right?
Yeah.
And I love being surprised. And my audience knows, like, I'm not a natural book reader, right?
Okay.
Okay. I think about television first, right?
You're a visual person.
I'm a visual person.
And that's okay.
And I'm like, if I have to bring something else into my mind, I have to be smart on. But I love when a book surprises me, right?
Okay.
And your book was one of those surprising moments because it's very practical, right?
Yeah.
It's very
teachable,
right?
That's
and
idea.
One thing I love is that you're really helping individuals find their voice and their advocacy.
That's the idea,
And there's a statement of a framework, and you're just saying, like, if you didn't go to Model United Nations, which I did,
right?
Like, you don't get involved. involved in politics early on, like, you feel like you may not be lost in this space.
Right.
Talk to us about that thesis statement or that framework.
Yeah,
right? Like,
yeah.
Why was it important for you to write through that particular lens?
Yeah. So that was the whole idea of the book. Yes, it's memoir, and I talk about some really deep stuff and personal stuff that happened when I was growing up and even into my early adult life. But I've always wanted to lay a blueprint for people to really lay out how I got to where I got to. And a lot of it is because I have mentees, young people that I mentor, I teach at Columbia University, and they come up to me.
That was a stunt moment, by the way. I see you. Yeah. I mean, literally, we're just not worthy, right?
Yeah.
TV analyst, Ivy League professor, author, White House alum.
It took a lot of hard work.
I mean, we're not worthy. I mean, we're not worthy.
It took a lot of hard work, though. It wasn't easy.
Yeah.
But the book, I mean, that's the book, right?
Of course.
It talks about the promise of tomorrow, really talks about my immigrant story. I'm an immigrant. My parents clearly are immigrant. And so it talks about growing up in this country as an immigrant, especially with all of the anti-immigrant sentiments that we hear currently coming from our government. And so that's a big emphasis on it, because I was never, even though you just laid out all these wonderful things, all my the accolades and all my successes, growing up, I wasn't supposed to achieve those things. I was like a statistic that wasn't supposed to make it. And I was told that. I was told, oh, you're never going to be a doctor. You're never going to be this. You're never going to be successful because you come from a working class immigrant family. Yeah. And my first language wasn't English. I was always behind.
Yeah. Let's know, she's Haitian, by the way.
Yeah, I'm
too,
Haitian
as well. American.
Yes. And so that's a big part of it. And so writing the book, for any young girl or young person, young boy who feels this way, who feels like, oh, I've been told no.
Yeah.
I've been told I can't do this. Yeah. I wanted this book to be the book that showed them that they could.
Yeah.
So that's another big part of like telling the memoir, telling the personal story. And then it's a call to action. There's a call to action in the book, which is everybody needs to get politically involved. We're just talking about advocacy.
Yeah.
It is so important in using your voice. We're just talking about that too. It's so important to lend your voice for a cause that matters because so many people, we're all counting on each other.
Yeah.
And if we don't stand together, then we stand alone.
Literally.
And so that's part of the other message that I want, that call to action, that get involved.
Yeah.
Don't sit on the sidelines. We are in such an important, crazy moment right now in this history of this country.
Yeah.
And sitting back is not the answer.
It's not. I loved how, to me, what I was gathering from this is if anyone has felt other. Right?
Yeah, it's definitely
and
that.
And it felt like Mars lies and they could not do it, which is why I wanted to stop and pause. So I love to celebrate and amplify. Because I think for too often, people of color, we like to suppress our accolades, right?
Absolutely.
And really feel uncomfortable talking about that. But I believe in opposite. So I believe in the power of exposure. That is really key in helping us change the narrative of things. A lot of times, the reason why we feel like we can't do things, we don't see ourselves in places and spaces like this, right?
Right.
We don't see places and space on television and media, on the radio. Right, having these incredible careers and how to get there, and to know that someone is actually speaking at an Ivy League institution. So I wanted to make sure I highlight all of those things.
Yeah,
and
I appreciate
that's
that.
Not something to blow off, right?
Yeah, you're absolutely and to blow right. By. And we do so, that. We do.
So
we hide
often,
it. We don't lead with it.
We don't. Yeah. Where other groups lead with that, right?
Absolutely. And they were raised that way.
They were raised
right. And can I go back to?
Please,
can I go to?
Yeah.
This is why President Barack Obama was so such an powerful image.
Yeah.
You remember that picture where he bends over and that little black boy
touches that.
And was like, wow. It spoke volumes, because when he became president, it showed young black boys, young black girls that they could be president one day, because we're not taught at a young age that you can be president.
Yeah.
Nobody told me. Well, technically, I can't because I'm an immigrant.
Yeah.
But nobody told me that I could be a president one day.
Literally.
Right? You don't tell that to young black kids or kids of color. And so when you saw that, and it goes into what you were saying, representation.
Yes.
When you see that, there's something in you that makes you feel proud.
It does.
Right? And all that pride, and you, it really tells the story of I can do that too.
Yeah.
Right. And so that was part of the book as well. Representation.
Yeah.
Representation matters. When I was starting politics, there weren't a lot of you know, I think there was like, you know, I knew about like Shirley Chisholm, Maxine Waters, Barbara Jordan, Donna Brazile is somebody that I looked up into, but there wasn't a lot of us.
It's not.
There wasn't a lot of us.
And then on top of that is, how do we act in those spaces, right? And so I just did a conversation, I talk over the weekend at this tech conference in front of individuals about diversity in tech and mm-hmm. inclusion. Mm-hmm. And there's a young lady who stood up. And so she was like, how do you advocate in your space mm-hmm. for people of color when you're the only one, right? Mm-hmm. And she was saying she feels so uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. And literally, Karine, it was in that moment where I was so thankful for my Obama experience mm-hmm. because I came in, as you know, through the fundraising aspect of it, and at a very high level.
Yeah, you were, so in a you high were phenomenal. Level.
Yeah.
Thank you. Hence why I met with you off the record.
Exactly, off the record.
Whenever you came into town.
But that's it right there, though. But even for me, I had to learn.
Yeah.
Right? I had to learn how to exercise my voice and my capacity, because when you're sitting around the table and it's like a table of 10, right? Everyone is advocating for their own self-interest.
Right.
It blew me away. Right. Like, if there was a woman at the table, so what about the women? Right. If there was someone from the Latino community, but what about Latinos? What about immigration? If there was somebody from the LGBTQAI community who was like, well, what are we going to do about marriage equality?
Right?
And there was someone who was of Jewish descent. What about Israel?
Right.
And in a moment, I was like, oh, and don't let the boys from Wall Street be there,
right?
They're like, oh, what about all the things?
Right, all, the things.
All the economics.
All everything. The
and
money.
The money. And I was sitting being the only black at the table, and I was just in awe. Right. And I was like, how is this possible? Because I would feel so uncomfortable advocating for black, right? I'd be like, well, I was like, I'm here, I go, the angry black man.
Right.
Bringing up the black things
about,
again.
Which we worry about. Being stereotyped. That's a big
part
of it. Yeah.
Or saying, there goes a black guy asking a stupid question, right? Or there goes a black guy trying to do too much, right? But I learned by watching, right? And I was like, oh no, so I'm the first one with my hands up.
Yeah.
So what about the blacks?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
And then they think, oh, you should just be lucky that you're in the room.
Exactly.
Why are you talking?
Yes. And I'm like, no. So again, what about the blacks? And so I learned that experience. I found my voice in that uncomfortability. Yeah. Now I'm comfortable.
Yeah.
And then in that moment, there was this teachable exchange with me being on stage and this individual in the audience. I'm like, this is what it was for.
Right.
Hope I can encourage and empower her, which is why I'm so thankful you're at an organization like MoveOn.org, right?
Yeah.
That's why I'm so thankful that you do the work that you do, because we need blacks in progressive spaces too.
Absolutely.
As well,
which
for
could be
all
a
the reasons,
and it could be a problematic place to be. Is
yes,
I mean we have to be honest about our own stuff too.
We
do not see a diverse kind of array of people in the progressive space, which is shouldn't be.
Yeah,
but
so how did you learn how to exercise your voice? I'm curious. For me, it was in those roundtable moments. Like, when did you come to that realization? Like, let me say, identify as all the things of who I am, because in politics, we're all about identity. Politics, right? Like, we are comfortable in saying the uncomfortable things.
Right?
So how did you...
I have to tell you, Mike, I still do deal with that today.
Yeah.
It's not something that I overcome very easily. You know, when you met me, I was in government in the White House, and I was behind the scenes.
Yeah.
And when you're behind the scenes, you do things quietly. You know, you're talking to folks like yourself, trying to see how do we make change? How do we spread out the message? And now, working for Move On, and I've been there for the past 3 years, I'm in front of the camera.
Yeah.
Now, I am the one out there with the message, trying to educate people.
Mm-hmm.
And also, the moment that we were in was so critical the last 3 years under this particular presidency. It was one of those things where I felt where I had to do it.
Yeah.
Right? I had to do it because my voice was needed.
Yeah.
My voice was important. And people felt like they didn't have a voice.
Yeah.
And so it's awesome when I go out and people see me and they're like, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for what you say on TV. It's so great to see you back again to representation. And so that has built me up.
Yeah.
But like I said in the beginning of our conversation, I was a shy kid. I still am very shy.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm still working towards it. It's not something that's even easy to do.
Yeah.
I got to build myself up and understand when I'm in front of that camera, when I'm on that stage behind the podium, I'm talking for people and they hear me and they listen and they want to know what to do.
Yeah.
They want to be encouraged.
Mm-hmm.
They want to be motivated.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a responsibility that I take really carefully, and I understand that, and I respect it, and I honor it.
Well, thank you for that, and thank you for bringing authentic self to the conversation. As I told you, we can go anywhere in this conversation, and I'm sure your team is like, okay, Mike. So again, the book. So I'm going to reset this for 1 second to make sure you go out and support this book, Moving Forward: A Story of Hope, Hard Work, and the Promise of America. It is out now. Go to Amazon and go get it. So with that being said, as we reset about the book, there is something I wanted to pull out in the book that I think is very indicative of where we are right now, as we are just in, and you set the table really perfectly in terms of where we are in our government, our democracy, but also too where we are in the 2020 presidential race, right? We're in the thick of things, and everyone has a flaw, right? And I think the reason why we don't sometimes we don't get the best candidates that are out there because sometimes the best candidates who never run because they have imperfections, and they feel like they have to be this Manchurian candidate, and I think that has been a challenge that we have had in this country of always wanting that perfect candidate. Who's never done anything wrong, who needs to be the representation for whatever office that we're in. But our candidates are flawed because we're human. Humans are flawed. And you talk about that a lot in the book, about flawed candidates. Talk to us about your perspective on flawed candidates and why we should focus on the message, right? And I always like the messenger.
That's something that I learned through my process, through my career, where I worked for two in particular flawed candidates. I talk about it more deeply in the book. And sometimes you can't control that. It's not, and when you're a staffer, it's not your fault that the person is flawed. And when you work on presidential campaigns, and you know this, you work 6-7 days a week, you give 12 to 15 hours. And I always tell my students that when you go work for a candidate, you got to believe in them because you're giving so much of your time. And but then there's that line that you have to be really careful because people are flawed. And you may not know it at the time, and people are flawed. And a lot of people who run, there's a narcissism there, right? You do not run for office. You run for office thinking you're the best.
Because you're the greatest.
You're the greatest, and you are
the
smartest.
Only person.
Right?
And I'm also probably going to vote for me.
So there's that level, too, right, that you have to deal with a candidate. And so I learned really quickly that you can't put people on a pedestal, right? It's important to believe in their platform and their issues, and you got to believe in something, right? Or else you fall for anything. Right? There's that saying, and so there. I talk about that line, or that, you know, that merging of the lines, and to be really mindful and careful, because the other part of it too is, if you work for a flawed candidate, you have to think about yourself and your career.
You do.
Right? Because that is just a reality. You got to figure out how you're going to pivot. What is your trajectory? And I talk about that a lot. And there's a whole chapter, as you know, in the book that speaks to that. And you know, I got very lucky. I worked for, in particular, two flawed candidates, and my career still continued. And because I think it's because I believed in myself, I believed in what I believed in, and I just followed kind of that road of who am I, what do I stand for, and focusing on my career, which is really important, and we have to do that.
I love that. I love where you landed with that, just because it speaks to authenticity, right? And I think in art and entertainment, those of us who are most authentic, those of us who are most vulnerable, connect really well with the audience, and those are individuals who end up being most successful and have longevity. And I love how you are even juxtaposing that to a political career, right? And staying true and authentic to yourself. And when you say true and authentic to yourself, let that be the guiding light, the North Star, that kind of guides you into that next space. And then that you will be okay. But it's also believing what you want to believe in. I think like with you have flawed candidates, and then you had someone say a perfect candidate. You know, with Obama. And one would say that my track record's a stunt a little bit. I never worked with a candidate that's lost. So I've always had winning candidates.
You know how to pick them.
I do. I tell people, listen to me. But even in 2016, I said Trump was going to get it.
Wow.
I'm on record, and I said that.
All right, so I'm gonna put you on record. So in 2020, what's your pick? What do you say?
Wow.
You're on the record.
I can't let you turn the tide on me. I can't let you do that. And my audience knows I always answer questions. Never dodge.
That's great.
I hate when people dodge.
All right,
It's a personal pet peeve of mine. So you challenged me.
Challenge.
Now I have to answer. I hate that I was tracking her down so hard now to get this interview. I know she's going to do something. I've done that. I think the Democrats have to look at things in a unique way. I think that Democrats always want to be the smartest people in the room, and I don't think that's where we are right now. I think that Democrats have to be careful that, you know, they are thinking with their head and not their heart. I think a lot of Democrats are leading with their heart, and not thinking about the political dynamics and structures, not really thinking about it comes down to really just about two or three states, and how the makeup of those two or three states are.
270 electoral college
exactly.
votes.
Exactly. Yeah. So I would say it's too early for me to call it, so I'm going to wait for the head-to-head general, and I'll call it then. So you have to come on the show and I will call it once the general begins.
All right.
But I'll say for the primary, my top four are, in no particular order, are, I see it, are Buttigieg, Warren, Sanders, and Biden. So those are my top four in no particular order. I think that when it comes down to who is capable of getting on the primaries and the general, it's Biden. By the others, I don't know. I'm not saying they're, I don't like the other ones, but it's just, I don't know. Right.
And you're thinking with your
with my mind, my heart,
not your heart.
Yeah,
and it's interesting because
it comes
in 2008,
down to two or three states.
In 2008, it was with the heart.
It was with the heart, and that's really what it was.
Yeah, but now we're in a different playing field.
A different playing field, a different space. We're more polarized than ever.
Right.
The stakes are greater than like literally the stakes are greater than ever.
Right.
So the first time I'm thinking about our democracy.
Right.
Literally, Karine, I'm not even thinking about policy.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking about that's how bad I feel like we are in America now, where I don't even care about policy anymore. At this, I'm like, God save, like literally save America.
I mean, we are a young democracy, and I think people forget that.
We forget it.
We are a very young democracy.
And so I get it, but that kind of goes back to, you know, everyone I mentioned and also to everyone I didn't mention is a flawed candidate, right? And different aspects of the party isn't happy one way or another because of one thing.
Right.
And so for me, that is my four. I think that would kind of make it out of the primaries or has the potential to make one has the potential to make it out of the primaries. Who comes up to the general, then you have to come back.
We'll come back.
Yeah.
Because every person that you mentioned is so different from each other.
So different.
And it would and the makeup of the general election would be different
with
any of them.
With any of them.
You have to have a different strategy. You have to have a different play. But I would argue it doesn't matter who the Democratic nominee is. They have to be able to build a movement.
Oh, they have to.
They have to.
And they have to reach across. And you deal with this. When I cannot go anywhere in America without someone coming up to me and talking about politics and getting my opinion. And when you really engage with a broad swath of America, you really get a chance to understand how people think and how they move.
Yeah.
And it's not a slam dunk against
President
Trump.
It's not what
we say
in New York or D.C.
It's not. And I'm so thankful I have that ability to get out of New York and D.C. and L.A.
Right.
And really get into the heartbeat of it. And so that's what makes this so interesting. And I'm also going to say you just don't know. But to your point, I was also the one who led with my heart. And that's the reason why I think I did so well, because I didn't care about the states.
Right.
But this is the first time I'm really thinking about strategy.
Wow, that's so interesting.
What about you? How are you thinking about this?
You know, I work for Move On, so I can't.
Oh, that's right.
I mean, that's just the truth, so I would get in trouble.
Yeah, yeah.
I think more of, like I said, we're going to need a movement. We are got to make sure we get young people back in. We got to have that Obama coalition.
Yeah.
And we do have to inspire people.
Yeah.
I think that is incredibly important to inspire people. And we just can't we can't fall for what's going on the other side.
Yeah,
we just got to do our business and be focused and work hard. And but, you know, there's so many other things I talk about in my book, voter suppression. Right?
Oh,
that's a
God,
real
Jesus
thing
Christ,
that we have to deal with. And there's some, you know, Donald Trump won because it was a perfect storm.
Yeah.
Voter suppression was one of them. Misinformation was another.
Yeah.
Russia.
I mean, so many things.
There were so many things, and it was a perfect storm. And I worry. Those are the things that I worry about.
Yeah. And I want to make sure whatever candidate, this is insert petty moment, I want to make sure whatever candidate gets out of the primary and goes into general, please stop by Michigan. That's all I ask. That's all I ask, Karine.
Is this
we do that,
well,
right? And
then the blue wall,
that's kind of important.
270.
Yeah, I mean, like, just drive by.
Just drive by, wave to the people. Wave to the people.
You don't even have to get out the car.
Let them know you're in the state.
This is the state.
Just
drive down Woodward Avenue and just wave.
Wave.
That's all. I just hope that whatever candidate is listening, just please, for heaven's sake,
just don't take anything for granted.
That's it.
Don't leave anything. anything on the floor.
And wait, don't leave any money in your bank account.
Leave
it all on the table.
Don't campaign for Senate candidates.
None of that.
Like, I know, yeah, there's a lot of things.
Yeah, I think you guys are hearing what we're saying. So with that, we better wrap before your team is like, okay, Mike, you guys are going too far now. Remember, Karine, you have a day job. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
This has been absolutely amazing. Sorry I'm grabbing you.
We're grabbing.
Yeah, it's almost like therapy.
I heard, hold on. I heard you were hitting your
I
last.
Was. I was destroying that individual. Oh, my God. And I was like, oh, my God, I'm so sorry, right? But I started having fun. I get touchy-feely. It's not good in this era to be touchy-feely with people. Jesus Christ.
It's all love.
It's all love, though. Ladies and gentlemen, as you can see, it's a fantastic conversation. The book is even better than conversation, if you can believe it.
Yeah,
and that's me being humble.
Book.
Yeah.
Get the book. It's good.
It's so good. Ladies and gentlemen, the author, the incredible dynamic, the incredible advocate who's found her voice, Karine Jean-Pierre, moving forward, a story of hope, hard work, and the promise of America. Go get it now.
Get the book.
Don't delay. It's holiday season.
Yes.
Happy holidays.
Right. Get some gifts.
We got to come back and talk about that. That Mariah Carey song that was trending on Twitter literally triggered me. I'm like, the year is over. But anyway, that's another conversation another day. Until next time, folks. Peace.
So I'm going to stand up, take my people.